clinical approach to gait disorder. And in the second half, I may continue this and a brief talk about the vertigo. Now, this is how the patients come to us in the outpatient department. Doctor, I am not able to walk properly. So it is a very, very vague way of presentation. Or they say, I have got giddiness, dizziness. When you ask them specifically, they'll say while walking. So that so-called giddiness while walking is actually imbalance. So don't just presume that giddiness is equal to vertigo. So we'll have to ask a specific question, when does it occur? So many patients complain of giddiness only when you further elaborate the story, you find that it is giddiness only on walking. Others may say, I have difficulty in walking. We'll have to find out what the difficulty is. I tend to fall when I walk. Some are very intelligent when they say that I do not have balance while walking. Now, that is a very straightforward diagnosis that they don't have balance while walking. Some of them are even more intelligent. They say, doctor, I have got a good strength in my legs. I can kick the football, but I can't walk properly. Or some say, as though I walk like a drunkard. That's what all my people tell you. So that is an ataxia. Now, in the earlier classes, we have seen that ultimately the motor power in the lower limbs is required to execute the function. Now, the motor power, for example, if I have to say, let me start walking, that idea should generate, and then from the frontal motor cortex, it comes down through the spinal cord into the anterior horn cell. So that means there is a cognition. Then there is a upper motor neuron, which comes to the anterior horn cell. Then there is an anterior root. Then there is a neuromuscular junction, and there is a muscle. So in the earlier classes, we have already finished about the cognition, that is a dementia, then spinal cord, that is a myelopathy, then anterior root, radiculopathy, GB syndrome, peripheral nerve, peripheral neuropathy, neuromuscular junction, myasthenia, and muscle, that is a myopathy. So everything is in order, but yet the patient is not able to walk properly. The motor system is completely intact, but the patient is not able to walk steadily. That is called as gait ataxia. So ataxia is described as the lack of muscle coordination when a voluntary movement is attempted. So even though the entire motor system right up to the muscle is intact, it requires another input from the cerebellum for proper coordination. So the coordination need not be only in the lower limbs. Even in the upper limbs, there may be incoordination. The patient is not able to eat food properly because the coordination is not possible. So the bottom line is motor power is very good, yet the patient has difficulty in walking. Even the coordination of the muscles of the speech may be affected, causing dysarthria. Now, how does a normal gait depend on? I think this must understand for proper analysis. The afferents are sensory inputs into the brain. The position of the legs, the sensory input of position of the legs consists of visual, proprioceptive, receiving position and joint sense and muscle spindles, that is the posterior column. So we need an intact posterior column which sends the information to the brain where our feet are. So whether your foot is in the mouth or whether his foot is on the ground depends on the posterior column information. So that's why whenever there is a posterior column dysfunction, patient has what is called as a sensory ataxia. The efferent, the motor system right from the brain down, comes down to the muscle, but in between the cerebellum joins and cerebellum directs the coordination. In addition, vestibular component and cognition, the memory part of it, is very important. The cerebellum may be normal, the legs are normal, the motor system is normal. The person is unable to understand what he is supposed to do, as it happens in dementia. So remember, motor power is normal, and it is the motor power in the lower limbs which has to execute the movement. Now, in all clinical neurological diagnosis, as I keep telling you, there are four steps. First is what is the neurological deficit? Then what is the anatomical localization for that? Then depending on the story, whether it is acute, subacute, we assume what is the pathological diagnosis, and finally we look for etiological diagnosis. Sometimes the patient may have a combination of physical signs. Classically, the patient has upper motor neuron and posterior column dysfunction. Then you have to ask yourself, why has the patient come to me? Okay, difficulty in walking. What is that due to? Is it a sensory or is it a motor problem? Then only you will be able to answer the question of the patient. Now, how do we approach ataxia? First thing is, when the patient comes to us, doctor, I got difficulty in walking. As I told you, the various symptoms for which the patient come to us. So you will have to find out what is the difficulty. First confirm that it is due to ataxia. Once you say it is ataxia, then you have to find out what type of ataxia. Once you know what type of ataxia, then we go to the cause of ataxia and look for treatable conditions. Now, step one is it ataxia? So when a patient comes for difficulty in walking, look for non-neurological. Not infrequently, I see patients with osteoarthritis coming to me saying that I cannot walk, I've got difficulty in walking. And I said, why did you come to me? Yours is a joint problem. No, no, you had cured my earlier patient who had a GB syndrome. He also had a proximal muscle weakness and difficulty in walking. So that patient has referred, you go to so-and-so, they will cure you. So first you have to make out what the problem is. Then objective evidence of neurological is important. Psychogenic, we'll come to it in the end. So first thing is to assure that motor system is intact. So how do you examine the motor system? Please go through the same steps: nutrition, tone, power, coordination, and abnormal movements. The motor system was so beautifully structured. You should look for wasting tone. Suppose the patient has a lot of spasticity, you cannot examine the power. But suppose the tone is normal, the power is 2x5 or 3x5, then you know the difficulty in walking is because of the motor system. When you find that there is no spasticity, the tone is normal, power is 5x5, but yet the patient has poor coordination, that means we are talking about ataxia. So please go through the steps, find out that it is really due to ataxia. Now, examination of the patient on the couch is much less rewarding. Always I tell, examine the patient for the difficulty for which he has come. Now, for example, some patients will say they have got difficulty in writing. No point in examining in detail only the hand. Ask him to take the pen and start writing. You get a diagnosis that this is a focal dystonia, which you won't get it by motor system exam, reflexes and all that. So in this case, we are talking about difficulty in walking. So all you have to do is you can sit on your chair and ask the patient to start walking. Get up from the chair and start walking. If he is able to get up from the chair without difficulty, that means the proximal muscles are normal. Then ask him to walk normally. If you find the patient is able to walk normally, then ask him to walk faster and then quick turn. In early cerebellar dysfunction, they are able to walk normally, but to walk faster, when they quickly turn, they try to stagger and fall down. So that is very important. Now in early lesions, you must ask for the quick turn. Then you can examine on heels, that means dorsiflexion is good, ankle, on toes, plantar flexion is good, tandem, that means coordination is good. They can do a tandem forwards and tandem gait backwards also. Get up from squatting, I already told you. When he can do all these things and still the patient says, I have got difficulty in walking, I have got imbalance, that means it is a psychogenic problem. So if he can do all this, then ask him to hop on one leg and then hop on the other leg. If a person can hop on one leg and the other leg on a straight line, that means his neurological system is perfectly normal. Entire body weight is carried on one leg. Motor system is excellent and is able to hop on the same line. So that means the coordination is very good. So I think this will tell us if everything is normal and yet the patient subjectively complains of imbalance, that is a psychogenic ataxia, not uncommon. In the OPD, we see quite often. Lastly, you may do a Romberg sign. Now, this is just to differentiate all these causes. The difficulty in walking is the complaint. Is it a motor weakness? This we have already gone through last time, UMN or LMN. Okay, motor weakness is not there. Is it due to stiffness of limbs? It can be spasticity or it can be rigidity. Occasionally, dystonia and stiff person. Or is it really due to incoordination? If it is ataxia, either cerebellar or sensory or vestibular, there's nothing more. So first you have to eliminate motor weakness, eliminate stiffness of limbs, and then still the patient has problem, then it is an ataxia. You will have to find out which type of ataxia. If everything is normal, it is what is called as a phobic disorder or psychological problem. Now, give you an example. This was a patient seen by me with a history of diabetes of 15 years and difficulty in walking and imbalance of 1 year duration. So the patient was asked, do you have tingling numbness? He said, yes, I have got tingling numbness. With 15 years diabetes, of course, you will have tingling numbness. So diagnosis was made as peripheral neuropathy and B1, B6, B12 given. No conduction confirmed that patient has neuropathy. But when I made him to walk, I saw that he had a spastic gait. So the moment he had a spastic gait and he has got a posterior column disturbance, so it is a combination of the two. But what is the difficulty in walking due to? It is not because of the numbness and sensory problem, it is because of spasticity. When I got a MR thoracic spine done, you see that thoracic cord is compressed. The thoracic cord, a bony compression, which is responsible for his thoracic spinal cord involvement. And a surgery was done, decompression, and they had excellent relief. So ask yourself, what is the main difficulty of this patient? It is the spasticity. Of course, he has peripheral neuropathy. So whenever there are combination, you should ask yourself, what is causing the problem? Now, the another example. 65-year-old male had a difficulty in walking and frequent falls of 1 year duration. So as usual, 65 male and all, MR brain, MR entire spine, carotid Doppler, EEG, nerve conduction. I am not exaggerating. This is what is happening. So when they did everything, all they found was a few lacunar infarcts. And so they started giving the antiplatelet drug. So again, ask him to walk. He had a postural imbalance and he had an axial rigidity. This was a case of PSP, Parkinson plus, and an MR scan showed a beak appearance. Now, what is the clinical clue? Frequent falls in the first one year, suspect it is a paraspinal rigidity which causes the moment it turns like this, it tends to fall backwards. One question you ask, when he's getting out of the bed or getting out of the chair, does he fall backwards? And they say, yes, doctor, so many times he has fallen backwards. PSP, diagnosis, clinical neurology. You will not get all the time this, and you get many times this beak appearance, parrot beak appearance in a normal person also in that age group. So don't make a diagnosis on the beak appearance. This is a straightforward case, a young man with a progressive unsteadiness, difficulty to eat food, speech, and also obviously it is a cerebellar dysfunction. When a person has only gait problem, then it can be any of the three. Yeah, investigation without a clinical diagnosis, my favorite slide. He is like wearing a necktie without clothes. You put a tie only after you put all your clothes. So just doing random investigation and following some investigation finding is of no use. Now we come to, okay, ataxia is there. What type of ataxia? So we have four varieties of ataxia. As long as the patient's problem is only lower lip ataxia, then it can be any of the four. Any of the four. The moment the patient has upper limb ataxia, then it is 9 out of 10 times it is cerebellar. Once in a way, it can be sensory. The moment the speech is involved, cerebellar. So as the patient is talking to you, dysarthric speech, I have got imbalance, drunkard gait, it is a spot diagnosis that it is cerebellar. So let me repeat, only lower limb ataxia, it can be any of this. Upper limb also, in addition to lower limb, 9 out of 10 times cerebellar, sometimes it may be sensory. And once the speech is involved, is absolutely no other problem. Now how do we distinguish? Again, my favorite word, tell me who your friends are and I'll tell you who you are. That means you have come for ataxia, but tell me who are the friends of ataxia? What are the other symptoms to localize the ataxia due to any one of them? So let us see who are the friends. A cerebellar ataxia is due to cerebellum or its connections in the brainstem. For example, in multiple sclerosis, cerebellum is not affected, but there is a demyelinating plaque in the brainstem affecting the cerebellar connections. And so the patient may come for cerebellar ataxia. So cerebellar ataxia can be due to cerebellum or due to connections in the brainstem. Who are the friends? As I told you, dysarthria, obviously it is cerebellar. Other things are there, dysmetria, hyporeflexia, hypotonia, and multidirectional nystagmus. So if you think it is a cerebellar problem, because these are the friends, then ask for MR brain. Now, who are the friends in sensory ataxia? Sensory ataxia is due to loss of proprioception, posterior column dysfunction. Now, the posterior column starts from peripheral nerve, goes up to the posterior root. So from the peripheral nerve, go to the posterior root, and then it ascends up in the posterior column of the spinal cord. If you know this, then you know what are all the associated features. If it is a neuropathy, other symptoms, the other friends are tingling, numbness, distal symmetry. If it is a sensory radiculopathy, there will be a root pain. If it is a posterior column, then there is an associated UMN signs. You got it. Neurology is so easy. First you said ataxia, then you said whether it is cerebellar, look at the friends. Sensory, look at the friends. Not only it will tell you sensory, but it will tell you whether it is a nerve, root or posterior column. So here the investigations are, if it is peripheral neuropathy, nerve conduction and FNH. If it is a radiculopathy, again nerve conduction, FNH. If it is a spinal cord, you look for a MR spinal cord. The third variety is the vestibular. So whenever there is a vestibular system involvement in there, there is a severe vertigo, vomiting and sweating. So when those things are there, then we know that it is a vestibular system involvement. If vestibular nucleus is involved in the brainstem, then will be brainstem symptoms are there. So the patient has diplopia, dysarthria, dysphagia, severe vertigo, then we know that it is a brainstem involvement. Okay, let us go into a little bit details about the each type of ataxia. Let us see the vestibular ataxia. The clinical features are true vertigo. I use the word true vertigo because many people say I've got giddiness, I've got dizziness and all. The first question I ask is, do you have the spin? Some people, some patients are very intelligent. They say, doctor, the whole roof and building was just rotating like this. I had to hold the cot because of that. You got the answer. That is a true vertigo. Now, anything that is not spinning is not a true vertigo. It may be dizziness, etc., etc., etc. So, a true vertigo is a spin sensation. In addition, they have so much of spinning sensation, they have vomiting and sweating also. So these are the typical symptoms of a vestibular system involvement. And when they start walking, they have ataxia. If the vestibular system can be in any one of the localization, it may be in the labyrinth, it may be in the vestibular nerve, or it may be in the vestibular nucleus in the pons. So first thing is, I said, okay, this man ataxia is because of vestibular system involvement. Why did I say that? Because he has got a true spinning, which you will not get in sensory or cerebellar, and vomiting and sweating is there. So okay, the vestibular system is again for here or in the nerve or in the pons. So again, it depends upon the friends. If it is in the labyrinth, the patient has got hearing impairment also. You remember hearing impairment, tinnitus, and episodes of vertigo and ataxia, that is Meniere's disease. So ask for the component of eighth nerve, that is auditory, if they have hearing impairment or tinnitus, one is positive, another is a negative symptom, with episodes of ataxia, then we know that it is a labyrinthine involvement, that is a Meniere's disease. Vestibular nerve is a standalone vestibular symptoms of vomiting, sweating and all. Vestibular nucleus, I am sure you understand, once the brainstem is involved, what are all the other features, brainstem nuclei, cranial nerves will be there. Now this is a common problem in day-to-day practice. A 58-year-old female woke up with, she was all right in the night, she woke up with vertigo, vomiting, and she was not able to go to the washroom because of ataxia. After a few minutes, she was all right. Again, made an attempt to go to the bathroom. She could walk. When she bent her head to wash, to brush the teeth, again, she had a giddiness. But the patient will say, doctor, since morning, I have got imbalance. I have got ataxia or imbalance. Then quickly you do MR brain, because diagnosis, 58-year-old hypertensive brainstem stroke. But you will have to analyze the story. Do you get vertigo for a few seconds and then it stops and again it comes? Then there's yes, it is not continuous. Then the relative will say, sir, in between, after brushing, she could walk normally to the dining room. She had her coffee. Now that cannot happen if it is a continuous ataxia, which happens in brainstem stroke. Brainstem stroke, the continuous ataxia will be there. So here, whenever they bend forwards, whenever they turn their head, whenever they brush, whenever they turn in the bed, but they will say, I have got all the time ataxia. You will have to sit and analyze. Now, this is a commonest ataxia, that is the benign positional vertigo. No need for MR brain. It is a clinical diagnosis. Now, in between, when the acute episode stops, they still have fear of balance. Now that has to be addressed with minor tranquilizers. Because why do you say fear of balance? You examine the patient, she has no gait imbalance. If it is a brainstem stroke with cerebellar involvement, you will find the patient has difficulty to tandem gait, turns and all. So neurological examination normal, but patient has a fear of balance. It is a residual effect of benign positional vertigo. So that is the labyrinthine problem. But suppose the vestibular ataxia is due to vestibular neuronitis. Now vestibular neuronitis and labyrinthitis, the symptoms are same. The only difference is in labyrinthitis, there is also hearing impairment. In vestibular, there is no hearing impairment. Now how does this differ from positional vertigo? Positional vertigo is a self-explanatory. Change of position brings rise to spin. Vestibular neuronitis is like Bell's palsy. Bell's palsy is the seventh nerve. Now this is the eighth nerve. So it doesn't disappear in minutes. It is an enduring problem which goes on for several hours to even a couple of days. They start with vestibular symptom, spinning, vomiting, sweating, and imbalance. But the imbalance continues for several hours. There is no other feature of brainstem. So it is something like a Bell's palsy. The treatment is like Bell's palsy, steroids for 1 week and symptomatic therapy of anti-vertigo. So that is how you differentiate positional vertigo from vestibular neuronitis. How do you differentiate vestibular neuronitis from brainstem infarct? There are no friends of brainstem. It's a pure vestibular symptoms. Now this table will differentiate the three of them: positional vertigo, vestibular neuronitis, labyrinthitis, and brainstem. So once you make a diagnosis of ataxia and say it is a vestibular dysfunction, further localization, as already told you, positional vertigo is depends on the position and lasts for a few seconds to a minute. Vestibular neuronitis like Bell's palsy, but a shorter version, 1 to 3 days. And labyrinthitis, again, same as vestibular neuronitis, but there is an additional of hearing impairment. If it is a brainstem VBI, patient will have dysarthria, dysphagia. Even if it is a transient, there will be dysarthria, dysphagia. And clinically, you can see all this. I think another 1 minute is there. We'll continue when it stops. Now, the second variety is the sensory ataxia. Now, to recollect, the sensory ataxia is the inputs from the position and joint sense to the brain. So even if, suppose the lights go off in the night, if you are familiar with the topography of your room, you are able to walk even in the dark without light, thanks to sensory inputs from the feet. But suppose the patient has sensory ataxia, that inputs are not there. So the moment the light goes off, they become extremely unstable. So the sensory from the posterior column sensations from the peripheral nerve to the posterior root, and then it goes up in the posterior column, and then it crosses over the medial lemniscus and the medulla, then goes to the thalamus, second neuron, and third neuron goes from thalamus to the posterior sensory cortex. Sensory ataxia, as I told you, that starts with the peripheral nerve, posterior root, posterior column in the spinal cord, crosses in the medulla, goes to the thalamus, from the thalamus to the postcentral cortex. So once you make a diagnosis of sensory ataxia, it can be anywhere in this route. So because of the impairment of proprioception, you can make out the patient has loss of position, vibration sense, and Romberg's is positive, because the patient, as I told you, if the lights go off in your own room, you are able to negotiate, because even though there is no light, no vision problem, vision is not there, the posterior column helps you. But in patients where the posterior column is deficient, they depend on the vision. So when they close their eyes for washing their face or while testing for the Romberg's, they have an imbalance. Now, how do we further localize, whether it is a peripheral nerve or a posterior root? Again, tell me who your friends are. If it is a peripheral nerve, we know that tingling, numbness, paresthesia. If it is a radiculopathy, the patient has a root pain. If it is a posterior column dysfunction, then there may be associated UMN signs. Now, a 45-year-old male, rapidly progressive gait imbalance. Speech and upper limbs are normal. So you do not know whether it is a cerebellum or a sensory ataxia. It is not vestibular because there was no vestibular symptom. So examination showed patient had a brisk tendon reflexes. So that means it is not cerebellar. It is something to do with UMN and sensory ataxia. So this localization is to the spinal cord, posterior column, and MR cervical cord showed an acute demyelination involving the posterior and lateral column. So you see how easy is neurology. Patient has got ataxia, and you have found that patient has a sensory ataxia, and the friend is a UMN sign. And so it has to be, both should be together, means it is in the spinal cord. So all you have to do is look for an investigation of the spinal cord. This is another common feature in clinical practice. A 65-year-old man, diabetic, hypertensive, complains of giddiness while walking and imbalance. So the giddiness is not sitting, lying down, standing. The so-called giddiness, which requires to be analyzed further, is actually an imbalance while walking. So because the patient is diabetic and patient has got imbalance. So they thought that whether it is a MR brain, just done like that, the patient had a lacunar infarct, put on aspirin clopidogrel. Now, how can a lacunar infarct cause only ataxia? Carotid Doppler 80% stenosis, he was advised left carotid artery stenting. Now, this patient had a diabetic neuropathy. Why diabetic neuropathy? The patient had features of peripheral neuropathy, Romberg sign positive. That is why it is a sensory ataxia. Then what about lacunar infarcts? Incidentally found. It is like graying of the hair and balding. And what about the stenosis? Again, incidentally found. See, all our blood vessels, where our body is like a old ambassador car. As we grow old, like the pipes get rusted in the house. So the coronary artery, vertebral artery, all these get rusted. So there will be stenosis. Because there is a stenosis, that doesn't mean the patient's ataxia is due to that. It must be, if it is a brain-related ataxia, it should be cerebellar ataxia. So please remember, little bit of analysis is all that is required. So if the patient has a sensory ataxia, what are the treatable conditions? Always remember treatable conditions. So whether it is a peripheral nerve involvement, the commonest cause is diabetes. If it is a rapidly progressing, just like a GB syndrome, which affects the motor roots, there is a sensory variety of GB syndrome, which affects the posterior root. So just like GB syndrome, within 24 to 48 hours, they have gross sensory ataxia, including the upper limb. In the initial part of the talk, I told you only lower limb, vestibular, sensory, cerebellar. Lower limb plus upper limb, most often cerebellar, sometimes it can be sensory. Now this is that sensory. Patient has a posterior root involvement in the upper limb. So upper limb also has got ataxia. In acute onset, then you think of a vestibular, think of a posterior root involvement. It is something like a GB syndrome sensory variety. The other one I told you, MS, multiple sclerosis. Spondylotic myelopathy is again a combination of UMN and posterior column, just like MS. Patient has sensory ataxia, spastic gait, then you know that the patient has a spinal cord disease. Now the history will tell, if it is MS, it is over a period of couple of days. If it is spondylotic myelopathy, it is stretched over a period of several months. So that is where the pathological diagnosis comes into picture. Slow progressive, same combination, spastic ataxic is a spondylotic myelopathy. But again, please see that this sort of a cervical spondylosis with even a myelomalacia, not Kuala Lumpur malacia, myelomalacia can be seen in normal individuals. So your diagnosis doesn't depend on the MR scan, it depends on your localization. Peripheral neuropathy, I have already talked to you. If the patient has a sensory ataxia, you have to look into all treatable conditions of peripheral neuropathy. So first you have made a diagnosis of difficulty in walking, then you said ataxia, then you said sensory ataxia, then you said sensory ataxia due to sensory neuropathy. Then look into all conditions and address that. The third variety is the cerebellar. Cerebellar ataxia, the patient has dysarthria and ataxia, it's a very obvious diagnosis. But if the patient has only lower limb ataxia, then the question is, what are you looking at? Incidentally, you may have diabetic peripheral neuropathy, but the diagnosis may be cerebellar ataxia. Now, cerebellar ataxia localization, there are two cerebellar hemispheres, as you know. If it is a unilateral, it is a structural lesion. Very important. Unilateral structural lesion. So not only you make a diagnosis of cerebellar, but you say that he has got a right-sided cerebellar ataxia. That means he has got a right cerebellar hemisphere lesion. You have to look for a structural cause. If the patient has bilateral cerebellar ataxia, patient has bilateral cerebellar ataxia, then you should look for a systemic cause. All systemic causes are eminently treatable conditions. So first is ataxia, then cerebellar ataxia, then bilateral, then it is a systemic cause to be looked into. If it is a very slow progressive disease, bilateral, then it is a degenerative disease. Neurology is so easy. If the cerebellar dysfunction can also occur in its connections in the brainstem, again, brainstem, you know who are all the friends. UMN, cranial involvement. Then you know that in MS, they come for ataxia and a brisk reflex. Then you know that it is a brainstem demyelination. This is what is called a truncal ataxia. Now, truncal ataxia is due to vermis. That is, the vermis is the joint between the two cerebellar hemispheres. So, in the vermis lesions, a midline tumor in the cerebellum can cause more of a truncal ataxia than a gait ataxia. They have more ataxia while sitting, but walking is not all that bad. If it is unilateral, the patient may have all the cerebellar features on one side only, incoordination, gait disorder because distal movement, all this you are quite familiar with. All these are unilateral. If it is a flocculonodular lobe is affected, then the patient will have nystagmus in addition to ataxia. So remember that all cerebellar lesions do not get nystagmus. Only if there is a flocculonodular lobe involvement, just tiny small lobe attached to the cerebellum, then nystagmus is very prominent. Now, slow progressive bilateral cerebellar ataxia, anything that is slow progressive over a period of couple of years is a degenerative disease. So there is a lot of, we used to diagnose in my days in neurology, OPCA, olivary nucleus in the pons and cerebellar atrophy, OPCA, look at the cerebellum, how much it is atrophy. Again, a caution. This type of cerebellar atrophy you can see in normal individuals in senior citizens. So patient has giddiness, cerebellar atrophy, don't make a diagnosis of cerebellar ataxia. Like people come to me, doctor, there is a cerebral atrophy is there, am I going to develop dementia? So I tell them it is not the quantity of brain, it is the quality of the brain. So similarly, once you have made a diagnosis of cerebellar ataxia, bilateral, slow progressive, and then you can see there is a atrophy of the cerebellum. But we are more interested in treatable conditions. So if the patient has an acute and unilateral, it is obviously a structural lesion. The commonest structural lesion we see is a cerebellar infarction or cerebellar hemorrhage. Acute onset, unilateral, localization to the cerebellum, you will find that either it is a VBI infarct or a hemorrhage. The patient has, in our olden days, we used to have a lot of children with otitis media. The pus used to burrow inside and cause a cerebellar abscess, a tumor. So anything unilateral, you must look for a structural lesion. And sometimes a unilateral may be because of the brainstem involvement on one side only. Now, if it is a bilateral, symmetric, all metabolic disorders are bilateral symmetric. There is a polymyositis, bilateral symmetric. There is a patient peripheral neuropathy, systemic, bilateral symmetric. So when it is a systemic condition, when it is a bilateral symmetric, look for a systemic condition. Alcohol, drugs, phenytoin in our neurology, anti-epileptic drug. Acute, a child with fever, cough, cold, and gross bilateral cerebellar ataxia. Now it is instead of encephalitis, it is a cerebellitis. Good prognosis. B1, B12 deficiency, not to forget. If it is slow progressive, look for hypothyroidism. And finally, one more partially treatable condition is the paraneoplastic syndrome. So remember treatable conditions. Look whether it is a unilateral, bilateral. Bilateral, look for the list of treatable conditions. Bilateral, slow progressive, it could be a degenerative disease, or it is not that slow. Within a matter of 6 months, the patient has gross ataxia, look for paraneoplastic or autoimmune syndrome. Now, this was a lady who had a right hemiparesis due to left cerebral infarct, recovered in 3 weeks, subsequently started gait imbalance. So the question was whether it is another stroke. But when you examined, this patient did not have a unilateral deficit. It was a bilateral gait imbalance. And patient was already had another MR brain, carotid Doppler, everything. So it was a bilateral symmetric cerebellar ataxia. I'm very, very particular about looking into the drug list. Please look into the drug list. Ask them to sit and write down all the drugs, homeopathy, allopathy, all pathies should be written there. Then I found that Eptoin 1 TDS, because many doctors, the moment there is a cerebrovascular accident, they put them on anti-epileptic drug. So this person had Eptoin as an anti-epileptic drug, even though there was no seizure. Now it is, senior citizens don't tolerate this high dose. So the patient had a drug-induced ataxia. Because patient did not have a seizure also, I tapered and stopped within a matter of 3-4 days. The follow-up 15 days later, perfectly normal. So bilateral, short duration, look for eminently treatable conditions. So these are the full list of treatable conditions. All of them have bilateral problem, and all of them have a short duration progressive cerebellar ataxia, which differentiates from degenerative disorders. Then finally, we go into the non-treatable conditions, very, very slow progressive, some years it takes, gradually, they can't even tell when it started. So insidiously it starts, bilateral, symmetrical, pure cerebellar ataxia. Now, my teacher, Dr. N.H. Wadia in Bombay, described this OPCA with slow eye movements. The saccades were lost. So when you ask the patient to look to the right, he first turns the head and then the eyes will turn to the right. Normally, when you say look to the right, we just move the eyes because we have saccades. Now, saccades are lost in this particular subtype of spinocerebellar ataxia. So that is called as cerebellar ataxia with slow eye movements. Described by my teacher, it's also called as a Wadia syndrome. Now, with all the genetic analysis coming in, it is a SCA2, spinocerebellar ataxia type 2 disease. So we have 10 to 11 subtypes of genetic disorders, but ultimately patient is not benefited. But it gives, for academic interest, it is very important for you to tell all this in your MD examination, because you have to first get married. MD examination has to finish. Then only you see a married life. That is the consultation. As a physician of consultation. Now the last type of ataxia is called as a psychogenic ataxia. This is not important for your MD exam, but this is very important to diagnose senior citizens coming to the OPD. Quite a number of them, they complain of imbalance in walking. And they have a great fear that they may be bedridden with a stroke. And this imbalance may be because of the forewarning of a stroke. I also told you last time, many patients come with zoom sensation in one hand, intermittently going on for 3 months. There is no neurological deficit. When I ask them, are you worried about stroke? They say, oh doctor, I don't want to be dependent on my family. I said, I also don't want. Who wants to be dependent? But this zoom is not stroke. So similarly, patients have psychogenic ataxia. Now, how do you make a diagnosis of psychogenic ataxia? It is a subjective feeling of imbalance. So you ask the person who goes with the patient for a walk. You ask the person, do you find the patient as imbalanced? No, doctor. He walks very briskly and very steadily. I don't see any imbalance, though he is complaining of imbalance for the last 6 months. That is a subjective feeling of imbalance. And also there are situational imbalance. They are damn scared of crossing the road. They get a lot of imbalance. But if a child, it is not the child being taken across the road by a mother. It is actually a child who is supporting the patient to walk across the road. So even with a small help, they are able to go confidently. Now that is again a psychogenic ataxia. When they are walking alone, they are more scared. The gait is variable, erratic, but the patient has never fallen. Neurological exam is normal, anxiety, depression or accompanying features. Best managed with anxiolytics and counseling. Now a 78-year-old man, hypertension, diabetes, he's got an unsteady feeling while walking and turning. He's not confident and so he walks very slowly. So he has got a slow gait, turning is a problem for him, and he has got unsteadiness. There are no neurological findings, no sensory, no cerebellar, no ataxia also on examination. What do you think is the possibility? This is called as a cautious gait. Cautious gait is very common in elderly, is very non-specific. Cautious gait. The gait, the patient is so cautiously he is walking. He is walking very slow. He is unsteady. He has got excessive fear of falling. Now this is due to multifactorial. He has got so many problems. Diabetic neuropathy, osteoarthritis, cognition problem, hearing problem, eye problem. I mean, every part of the ambassador car is poorly functioning. And no investigation required, because you will find lacunar infarct, spondylotic myelopathy and all. And what is the treatment? Walking stick with three legs. And it is amazing how many senior citizens do not want to have a walking stick. I tell them, you fall and break your femur, that is the biggest problem. So these are all the risk factors of multiple risk factors in the elderly. And so you need to address all this to see that the patient does not fall and break his bone. So what is the conclusion? Systematic approach for difficulty in walking. What is the difficulty in walking to? Ataxia. Okay, what type of ataxia? Sensory. Then where is the localization? What are the treatable causes? As simple as that. Neurology is actually simple, but stepwise. A few, two or three slides about the vertigo. Most of it I have already covered. Many patients, when they come to OPD, they'll say, some will say vertigo, some say dizziness, giddiness, floating sensation, sinking feeling, lightheadedness. These are all the varieties of we have another 7 minutes here. So these are the variety of symptoms they come for, and you have to sit and analyze what exactly is it. So if you don't take a proper history, okay, say, oh, you have got dizziness, must be vertigo. Or you have got maybe cervical spine, collar, surgery, low BP. If the patient doesn't have high BP, he will be having low BP. Give some tonics, give CT, MR brain, lacunar infarct, stent, surgery. All these things are reflex action by the doctor without taking proper history. Again, you will have to see whether it is a true vertigo or a pre-syncope or a gait imbalance. We have already talked about gait imbalance now. We have talked about pre-syncope and syncope in the transient ischemic attack in the stroke part. True vertigo, half of it we have already done. True vertigo, always ask for rotation feeling, and there is evidence of disabling symptoms. If the person says, I have got vertigo, I have got spinning sensation, then I ask him, what do you do at that time? Nothing, doctor, I have to walk on the footpath to catch the bus. Now if a person who has a spinning sensation, if he is walking on Bangalore footpath, not during COVID time, normal time, obviously it is not a true vertigo, no matter what he says, spinning or otherwise. So there is always associated problems if there is a true vertigo. Pre-syncope is just before the syncope. Before they fall down due to syncope, they have all these problems of darkening in front of eyes, floating sensation. They're all episodic. Gait imbalance, we have already said. People who have continuous episodes of all those symptoms which I told you in the first slide. All these symptoms are there sometime or other, going on for 6 months, not disabling, then again it is due to chronic anxiety. Benign positional vertigo, I told you. And this is the treatment you will have to give that. So in addition to anti-vertigo drugs in benign positional vertigo, you tell them not to turn the head, not to, to turn slowly in the bed, stand up, wait, and then start walking. And also do this procedure. It's called as a semantic procedure, where you sit on the bed, legs hanging down, touch your ear to the bed, get up, touch the ear other side. So do 10 times here, 10 times there. Like that, 3 sittings a day for 3 weeks is the most important for recurrent vertigo. The last point is Meniere's disease. This is episodic, true vertigo, episodic, because Meniere's disease has got a component of auditory and vestibular. So the auditory is in the background. Tinnitus and hearing is reduced, plus episodic vertigo which is going on. So that is a diagnosis of Meniere's disease. Unlike the positional vertigo, which is without auditory symptom and which is related to position, this lasts for an hour or two. So these are all the various drugs we give. The duration also will tell you. Positional vertigo is for a few seconds. Meniere's disease is for about an hour and a half. Vestibular neuronitis lasts for 1 or 2 days. There is one condition called as vertiginous migraine. Vestibular migraine. Very important, though not frequent. The patient comes to us for episodes of vertigo. It is not benign positional. It is not a Meniere's disease because there is no auditory symptom. But all the same, there are disabling episodes of vertigo. You are worried, why is he getting every month 2 attacks, 3 attacks? Ask for history of migraine. Previously, the patient had unilateral throbbing headache and all that, migraine headaches. And even this episode of vertigo, the patient has, in addition to vertigo, some symptoms of migraine like photophobia and phonophobia. So past history of migraine, present history of vertigo with photophobia, phonophobia, that is called as a vestibular migraine. Why should you make the diagnosis? The treatment is like for migraine. That is important. So you give anti-migraine drugs. So sebilium or propranolol and those drugs, not only anti-vertigo drugs. So this is a very important point. Again, the diagnosis purely by history.